Hello everyone, good morning, good afternoon, good evening, depending upon when you are watching this video lecture. Today let us discuss about Accounting Standard 12, that is related to government grants. When the organization receives certain types of government grants, how to treat those government grants in the books of accounts? Basically, this is more of a recognition related standard. In other words, basic accounting treatment. In other words, journal entries of government grants are prescribed by this particular standard. Entries will not be told by the standard. Standard will tell the treatment. From that, we have to understand and we should be able to write journal entries when an organization receives some government grants. What this AS-12 describes and prescribes about? It tells us about treatment of non-monetary government grants, if any. Non-monetary means not in the money form. For example, government gives a particular enterprise land. A lot of times we see that in the newspapers also, that so-and-so state government has given or allotted so-and-so many acres of land to particular company. Sometimes either free of cost or sometimes at a very concessional rate, whatever the policy of that government may be. So the companies might get certain non-government grants from the government. How to treat them will be described and prescribed by AS-12. And not only that, very particular item which is having more possibility of being asked as a question is presentation of grants related to specific fixed assets. So government is giving a grant to an organization in order to purchase a fixed asset. So that is related to a specific fixed asset, not a general capital grant, but grant is given in order to purchase a specific fixed asset. A lot of times this also is quite common, particularly in India. This alternative energy producing equipments like wind energy or solar energy, such type of equipments, when any organization purchases, government will give some subsidy to the organizations. In other words, just for example, if the asset costs 1 crore rupees, government may give the organization something like say 30% of that, 30 lakhs. So that the organization will spend 70 lakhs, government will spend 30 lakhs to acquire that asset. But that is a grant given by the government to the organization with an intention of promoting the organization to purchase a specified fixed asset. How to treat them is one of the aspects that AS-12 tells us. And not only that, revenue grants. Rare this is, not generally quite common, but still, whatever the rarity it is, Accounting Standard 12 tells us how to treat revenue grants. Revenue grants are those which are given by the government to the organizations for meeting their day-to-day expenses, for their regular activities and operations. How to treat them is one point. And sometimes the government may give grants in the nature of promoter's contribution, in the nature of promoter's contribution, like a capital grant. We can say without any specific fixed assets to be attached to that. So government tells, let us say, if a particular organization is going to invest 10 crores rupees in a particular backward area, I will give you 20% of that as my contribution. Like that, government may say, these are all examples. If it says that is a kind of capital grant, it is also part of the capital that the organization can use for establishing a new entity in that area. But still, government did not particularly tell about this asset to be purchased or that asset to be purchased. This is how this has to be spent. But of course, it will have a lot of conditions. That is a different story. But still, this grant is not a revenue grant, but it is in the nature of promoter's contribution. Neither it is related to a specific fixed asset. That is why we can call that as in general, as a generic capital grant. How to treat that is also another point that AS-12 tells us. And one more important point from examination point of view, how to deal with the refund of government grants. Okay, you received some government grants, you have passed some journal entries. Then when the conditions which are attached to that government grant are not fulfilled by the enterprise, then there might be a possibility that enterprise has to refund them. In such case, how to treat? That is also one thing that AS 12 tells us. These are the broad areas of Accounting Standard 12, which is related to accounting for government grants. We'll go through them one by one and we'll see what AS 12 tells us in dealing with these items one by one. First of all, before going to that, what is the meaning of a government grant? Of course, we don't need to by heart it. General, normal, common sense. Government grant is nothing but the assistance by the government, whether in cash or in kind, to an enterprise for the past or future compliance with certain conditions. So naturally, government grant is assistance that is given by the government to the enterprises, which also will be coming with certain conditions. So conditions will apply also along with government grants in general. There is no rule that without conditions, if government gives a grant, it is not a government grant. Government in general keeps conditions. Otherwise, people might utilize those grants in a manner which the government does not intend them to utilize. So, what government grant generally means is the assistance of the government to an organization or to a particular enterprise for past or future compliance, whether it is given in cash or kind with certain conditions. That's what is a government grant in general, what it means. Then look at the government grants. Recognition, when can it happen? This is also a general principle. Definition of government grant is just for general understanding. Recognition of government grant is also a general principle. When should we first of all recognize a government grant? This is important. Even from accounting point of view also. Why? Because a government grant is not recognized until there is a reasonable assurance. So government grant cannot be recognized as a grant, as a benefit in the books of accounts until there is a reasonable assurance. There should be reasonable assurance that what? Enterprise will comply with the conditions attached to it, and most importantly, the grant will be received. That is also a very important condition. There should be a reasonable assurance that the grant will be received. Just for example, say government just puts a press conference and tells that, okay, we are going to give 1 crore facility of grant to all software companies in India. Like that, if it tells. If the software company starts booking its revenue as if the grant is already received, that would be wrong. Because governments will keep on making 100 statements daily. Not necessarily that all the statements they will really fulfill. But on the other side, that statement may come with a lot of conditions. Not necessarily that every enterprise will be able to get that benefit. So, the enterprise cannot recognize the grant until and unless it has reasonable assurance that it is able to and it will be able to comply with the conditions attached to the grant, and most importantly, it has reasonable assurance that the grant will be received. And one more point to be noted here, the receipt of grant itself is not conclusive evidence that the conditions attaching to the grant have been or will be fulfilled. We don't know that. Conditions are different, receipt is different. Certain times, the conditions may be in such a way that they can never be fulfilled. Then you cannot recognize that grant, because there is no reasonable assurance that conditions will be fulfilled. Just because you received the grant, there is no guarantee that the conditions attached to that grant will be fulfilled. So receipt is not a conclusive evidence. The organization has to check itself whether it has the ability and whether it will be able to comply with the conditions attached to that grant or not. Yes, then look for another point, whether the grant will be received or not. Not necessarily you have to recognize it on receipt basis. But at least there is a reasonable assurance that the grant will be received or not. Yes, then only recognize the government grants. Otherwise, don't recognize government grants. Even if you received also, you may have to just recognize it as if it is a liability, not as a grant as income, not even as your own capital or your own reserves and surplus. But of course, this is something that more applicable in the real life, depending upon the actual conditions attached to the grant. Governments keep on giving variety types of grants, thousands of types and categories of grants it may give. So those all grants might have attached with them certain conditions. So the point of that organizations have to look at is whether they are able to follow that conditions or not, whether the grant will be received or not with a reasonable assurance. That is a recognition criteria for a government grant in a nutshell. That is once again crucial from a theoretical perspective, and in reality also that will be crucial about the recognition criteria. For our problems in the examination, of course we have to recognize it. Without that, what is there for us to do? If we say that grant itself is not recognized, there is no entries that you are going to pass. So that's why in general it will be an underlying assumption that we have to carry in all the problems that we encounter, that there is a reasonable assurance that the grant will be received, and there is a reasonable assurance that the conditions attached to the grant also might be fulfilled by the organization whenever they received the grant. So this is one underlying assumption that we can say for solving the problems. In reality, it is not the case. In reality, these have to be actually checked, and in accordance with the reality, in accordance with the facts, the organizations will have to react accordingly. That is the recognition criteria of government grants. Now let us jump into the actual situations of various types of government grants. One type of government grant is non-monetary government grants. Like what? In general, what government will have to give to people or to give to organizations other than money, what it will have? It is going to give maximum mostly land. If not that, other resources. Maybe, though it will not give freely. If at all, mines, minerals, nowadays even spectrum, 2G, 3G, 4G, 5G. These are all resources that government will have in its control. Of course, it is not going to give freely as grant. The examples of resources I am telling. Government will sell those resources to the organizations under normal circumstances. Imagine government was so generous and it wanted to give 5G spectrum as a grant. That is a resource. But that is a non-monetary grant. That is not a money that government is giving. It has money value, but it is not money itself. Land also. Land might have a lot of money value. Government, particularly state governments, because land is a state government subject in India. State governments give land to the enterprises, multinational organizations, tens of acres, hundreds of acres. We keep on listening to that. We keep on seeing that. So that is a non-monetary government grant. So this non-monetary government grants can be given on concessional rates, or they can be given at free of cost also. If they are given at concessional rate, how they have to be accounted for? They have to be accounted for at their actual acquisition cost. For example, government has granted 10 acres of land at the rate of 10 lakhs rupees each, whereas market value of that land at that time may be 15 lakhs or 20 lakhs. Government has allotted the land, or given, not allotted, just sold the land one way to this one organization of 10 acres of land at the rate of 10 lakhs rupees each. That means 1 crore rupees or 100 lakhs rupees is the land value that this organization has purchased. So there is no speciality in that. What entry it will pass? Land account at R to bank account. Whatever the cost of acquisition is actually there, that only it will write. So that will be there as a normal entry, depending upon whatever the actual cost may be. If it is at concessional rate, sometimes government gives them free of cost also. Government just allotted 10 acres of land, that's all. Market value may be of that 10 crores also, doesn't matter. But just government gave it to an organization. Lot of times state governments do that, of course, with a pretext of development, with a pretext of generating employment and generating economic activity within their states. Whatever it is, lot of times it so happens that the state governments allot lot of land to different corporates and other multinational organizations. It is quite common practice, particularly in India. So if it gives free of cost, if the land is given, for example, by the government to an organization free of cost, then should the organization just ignore it because it did not pay any money? and we know according to basic accounting principles, fundamental accounting principles, we need to follow money measurement concept. There is no money that organization has spent. So should it pass any entry or not comes the question. Some organizations say that no need to pass entry because there is nothing, no transaction. We just got land, that's all. There is only something incoming, there is nothing outgoing. So debit is there, credit is not there. So what should I credit? Organizations might ask. AS12 has the answer. AS12 said it has to be recorded at nominal value. Nominal means not some particular name. Nominal value means some value, whatever small it may be. Okay, 10 acres of land is allotted. No problem, record it at 100 rupees, maybe 10 rupees per acre like that. Record it, but it should be there in the record. It should be in the books of accounts of the organization. They cannot just ignore it. Just receive the land silently and just ignore it. No, that is not acceptable by AS12. AS12 says, even though you received a government grant, which is a non-monetary government grant, free of cost also, still you have to record it, but at whatever value, some nominal value. You want to record it at 1 rupee, no problem. Record it at 1 rupee or 10 rupees, 100 rupees. Some nominal value you can record it. Small amount also doesn't matter. But it should be recorded. It cannot be ignored. That is a very important point of non-monetary government grants received free of cost. When they are received at concessional rate, there is no specialty. Whatever the price that the organization actually pays, that asset will be recorded at that price only. Whatever the actual cost of acquisition. That's it. That is one category of government grants, which is non-monetary government grants. Now, the most important in this AS12 will be related to the government grants of specific fixed assets. That means government is giving a grant to an organization in order to acquire a specific fixed asset. Naturally, that asset will have depreciation and all. So, like that only, if there is a depreciation, then only we are looking at this. For example, if government gives a grant to an organization to purchase land, that is a different story. That will automatically be just considered as good as land being allotted at concessional rate. There is no big difference there. But fixed assets here, we are talking about depreciable assets. Accounting Standard 12 gives the option to the enterprises. There are two possible methods. Whatever the methods that may be, just for namesake, let us call them method 1 and method 2. There are two methods which the organizations can follow, not both, one of them they can choose. When they receive a government grant related to the specific fixed asset. Let us look at these methods one by one. Method 1. What is this method suggesting is the grant is shown as a deduction from the gross value of the asset concerned in arriving at its book value. So it is going to be reduced from the value of fixed asset. Just take a same example. Let us say an organization has purchased a fixed asset worth say 50,000 rupees. In that, government has given a grant of 10,000 rupees, let us say. So what should we do with this government grant? That will be reduced from the original cost. So now what is the actual cost of fixed asset after reducing the government grant which was received towards it is 40,000 rupees. So that is where the grant is shown as a deduction, reduced from the gross value of the asset concerned in arriving at its book value. That is one treatment. That's what method 1 says. Simply reducing the government grant from the cost of fixed assets. Then, what is the impact of this? Impact of this is what? Because of this, what happened? Simply, if you observe, the depreciation rate or the depreciation amount over the period of life of the asset has reduced, isn't it? Otherwise, without this grant, normally the asset should have been depreciated on 50,000 rupees. Let us say, just for example, say 10 years is the life of this asset. So, each year depreciation would have been 5,000. If this grant was not there, because of this treatment where you reduced this government grant from the original cost of the asset, now depreciable amount is only 40,000. So now how much is the depreciation? Only 4,000. So depreciation has reduced means, has the profit increased or not every year by 1,000 rupees? Yes. Like that, 10 years, the profit is going to be increased. Ultimately, government grant is a gain that has to be routed to the P&L account, but not in one shot. Since this is related to fixed assets, it cannot be recorded or recognized in one shot. In this particular example, it is recognized over a period of 10 years. That is the life of the asset. Through what? Through depreciation it is getting reflected in the profit and loss account by a lesser charge of depreciation, by which the profits will increase accordingly. That's what happens in case of this treatment is followed. So the grant is thus recognized in the P&L account over the useful life of a depreciable asset. How it is happening? By way of a reduced depreciation charge. That's what happens. Because of reduced depreciation charge, profits will increase year after year, but over how much number of years? Over the useful life of the asset. Whatever the life of the asset is, in all those years, profits will be inflated to the extent of the government grant by way of reduced depreciation charge. Now, where the grant equals the whole or virtually the whole of the cost of the asset, the asset is shown in the balance sheet at a nominal value. Imagine, if at all, not like generally it happens, if at all the grant is so much that it is almost equal to the whole of the cost of the asset. Let us say 50,000 rupees is the cost of the asset. Government is giving a grant of 49,000 rupees. Okay, no problem. Still it has to be shown at 1,000 rupees. Some nominal value it has to be shown. Imagine entire 50,000 rupees government only is giving. So you cannot say 50,000 rupees is the cost of the asset, entire money is given by government only. So there is no asset. No, you cannot take like that. That will again become as good as this non-monetary government grant free of cost, as good as, because it is giving the asset free of cost. In this case, it gives asset, or it gives full money to buy the asset, both are effectively same. But you cannot say I will record nil. You have to record it at 1 rupee also, 10 rupees also, 100 rupees also. Some nominal value it has to be recorded at. That's a rare scenario, but still, one point is for sure: when a government grant is received, it cannot be just ignored. Irrespective of whether there is a cash outflow or not, it has to be recorded at nominal value, whatever the grant it may be. That principle, if you remember, everywhere we can apply. But in general, what our important aspect here that we are going to use in the exam questions is, particularly the grants related to the specific fixed assets, how to treat them. If the question particularly says which method to be used, we use that. If it says nothing, we can use any of these methods, that is our choice. One of the methods is to reduce the government grant from the cost of the fixed assets, and as a result reducing the depreciation charge over the life of the asset, and as a result increasing the profits over all those years. That's it. That is method one. Let us look at an example of that with journal entries, how they have to be passed. These are the questions that actually that will come in the exam, so you have to be very careful. Nothing very great here, simple journal entries only, but logic and common sense prevails. What standard told, the essence definitely has to be remembered. Look at this situation. Z Limited purchased a fixed asset for 50 lakhs rupees, which has estimated useful life of 5 years and a salvage value of 5 lakhs rupees. So the cost of fixed asset is 50 lakhs, life of the asset is 5 years, and salvage value at the end of 5 years could be 5 lakhs. On purchase of the assets, the government granted it a grant for 10 lakhs rupees. Of course, cost of the fixed asset 50 lakhs is cost, but government has granted a grant of 10 lakhs. That means how much is the effective cost of this Z Limited when it purchased the fixed asset now? It will be only 40 lakhs, effectively. Pass necessary journal entries in the books of the company for the first 2 years. If the grant amount is deducted from the value of fixed asset, that is clearly given in the question. Grant amount is deducted from the value of fixed asset means method one. That's what we have to look at. And we have to pass necessary journal entries for the first 2 years. Life of the asset is 5 years. Generally, we will not be asked for more than 2 or 3 years. So after that, it is the same entries will repeat. So what kind of entries should be passed? Just imagine what happened initially. First of all, we purchased the fixed asset. When we purchased the fixed asset, definitely fixed asset account at R2, bank account 50 lakhs. Yes, that entry has to be passed. That is the purchase of fixed asset. But at the same time, we received a grant of 10 lakhs rupees from the government. So bank account at R2, fixed asset, because fixed asset is credited here means what? That is reduced from the value of fixed asset. So bank account at R2, fixed asset account 10 lakhs rupees. Narrations are compulsory. That is the second entry that we can pass. Now effectively, what is the value of fixed assets in the books of accounts? 50 minus 10, 40 lakhs. But what will be the depreciation charge here? So 40 lakhs minus 5 lakhs scrap value divided by 5 years, that will be divided by 5 years is 7 lakhs. 7 lakhs is going to be the depreciation charge each year. So first year, normal entry, depreciation account at R2, fixed asset account, P&L account at R2, depreciation account, 7 lakhs. Same entry will continue in the second year also. Depreciation entry, not others. What is the entry that will continue in second year? Depreciation account at R2, asset account. P&L account at R2, depreciation account. That's all. These are the entries that will be passed. You can look at them here. First year, what are the entries? When the asset is purchased, fixed assets account at R2. Bank account. That is when asset is purchased. When we received government grant, bank account at R2, fixed asset account. That means we reduced this grant from the value of fixed asset by creating the fixed assets account. Then depreciation is 7 lakhs. How 7 lakhs? 50 minus 10, 40 lakhs minus 5 lakhs scrap value divided by 5 years. So 35 by 5 years, that is equal to 7 lakhs. That is the depreciation. So depreciation account at R2, fixed assets account, 7 lakhs. P&L account at R2, depreciation account, 7 lakhs. These two entries better to be passed always. Don't write P&L account to fixed asset and all. That will not look good. Depreciation to fixed assets, P&L to depreciation. 7 lakhs, 7 lakhs. Done. Second year, same entry will be repeated. Depreciation to fixed asset, P&L account at R2, depreciation. That's it. These are the entries that will be passed in case of first method, where the grant is treated as a deduction from the value of fixed assets. That is method 1. Now, there is another alternative method also that the organizations might follow. Method 2, that is, where the grant which is related to the depreciable asset is treated as a deferred income. So it is treated as a deferred income. So we will not credit fixed asset account here. Rather, we can call it deferred government grant. Deferred, say, government grant. That means what? Government grant only, but separate account is created for that. And that will be recognized in the P&L account every year over the period of life of the assets. So how this will create? First of all, the organization will treat it as a deferred income, and then each year over the life of the asset, it will be recognized in the P&L statement on a systematic and rational basis. What is systematic rational basis? That depends upon situations. If nothing is mentioned, naturally straight line basis over the life of the asset. So in our earlier example, what we have taken, like this, 50,000, 10,000 example, what we have taken, let us take the same. 50,000 is the cost of the asset. We paid for it. Here we are not reducing 10,000 from that. 50,000 remains the same. 10,000 is treated as a deferred government grant. So here 10,000 will be treated separately. It is not reduced from the fixed assets cost. Fixed assets cost will continue to be 50,000 only. So depreciation will continue to be 5,000 only. There is no change in depreciation here. But how this 10,000 will be treated? Of course, because we imagined a 10 years life in that example. Each year 1,000 will be treated as income separately. So effectively it is the same. Effectively earlier we have decreased depreciation charge by which income was increased by 1,000. Our profit was increased by 1,000. Now, rather than doing that, we are treating this separately as a separate line item of income, 1,000 each over the useful life of the asset, taking this straight line basis as a systematic and rational basis. Not that it is the only basis. Any other rational basis can be used on the basis of situations. But taking the same example and same scenario, 1,000 is separately recognized as income. So here, deferred government grant account or any other name which is reflecting a deferred income can be created when the government grant is received. Naturally, that will be in the credit when it is received, bank account at R2. Deferred government grant account will be the entry when it is received. But each year, what happens? One portion of that deferred government grant will be transferred to P&L account. So each year, deferred government grant account at R2, P&L account, 1,000, 1,000, 1,000, like that, it will be credited to the P&L account. And by the end of the life of the asset, deferred government grant account becomes nullified. That is how also this government grant related to specific fixed assets can be treated. So simply, what is the treatment here? It is treated as a deferred income. Deferred means postponed. It is income, but the income recognition of that is postponed and spread over a period of life of the asset rather than recognizing it in the 1 year. So we call it deferred income. So that is another method, that is method number two, where we don't reduce the government grant from fixed assets, rather we treat it as a deferred income and recognize it over the period of life of the asset on some systematic and rational basis through P&L account separately. So here asset is separate, deferred government grant treatment is separate. We don't mix them. That is the second method or treatment of second method. Then, if at all, the grants are related to non-depreciable assets. If they are related to depreciable assets, we know these two treatments which are there. If the grant is related to a non-depreciable asset, then they are credited to capital reserve as there is usually no charge to the income in respect of such assets. Naturally, if that grant is related to a non-depreciable asset, then bank account at all to capital reserve will be the entry. So money is received, again not the asset is received. Money is received, but it is related to what? A non-depreciable asset. In that case, that grant has to be credited to the capital reserve. That is one special variety case, we can say. Then one more point. If the grant which is related to a non-depreciable asset requires the fulfillment of certain obligations, then the grant is credited to the income over the same period over which the cost of meeting such obligations is charged to the income. So, if at all it is related to some obligations also, over how many years of time these obligations have to be fulfilled, how much cost is going to be incurred to meet those obligations, in those years, such grant will have to be treated as income if this non-depreciable assets grant is related to fulfilling certain obligations over the period of time. So these two points are related to non-depreciable assets, which is also once again a rare scenario. But still, we need to know the treatment of all types of assets. First category of assets, which is non-monetary government grants. So government is not giving money, it is giving asset itself. That has to be recorded at nominal value if it is free of cost. If it is at concessional rate, it has to be recorded at whatever the actual cost of acquisition is. Then government grants related to depreciable assets or fixed assets which are depreciable. Then the grant can be reduced from the cost of the asset according to method 1, or it can be treated as deferred income also according to method 2. Both are possible in case of depreciable assets. In case the grant is related to a non-depreciable asset and there is no need to recognize any income throughout the life of that asset, if such is the situation, then the grant can be credited to capital reserve. If this non-depreciable assets related grant is to be fulfilling certain conditions or obligations over a period of time, then it can be recognized as income over the period of time during which those conditions will be fulfilled or obligations will be fulfilled, and cost of meeting those obligations is normally charged to the P&L account on debit side. This grant will be treated as income on the credit side of P&L account. That is about different types of assets. Now let us look at the same example with second method. Z Limited purchased fixed asset for 50 lakhs rupees, same 50 lakhs, useful life of 5 years, salvage value 5 lakhs. On purchase of the assets, government gave it a grant 10 lakhs. All data is same, but only point is, we are supposed to pass journal entries in the books of the company for the first 2 years if the grant is treated as deferred income. Earlier it was treated as reduction from the value of fixed assets. Now we are calling it as a deferred income. If this is a treatment, that means method 2. Under method 2, how this grant has to be treated in the books of accounts is what is asked here. Let us look at them carefully. First entry will be same, that is fixed assets account at R2 bank account. But second entry will be different. Here it is not bank account at R2 fixed assets. Rather it will be what? Bank account at R2 deferred government grant account. So that amount is 10 lakhs rupees. Then normally each year how much depreciation has to be provided? 50 lakhs is the original cost. 5 lakhs is salvage value. 5 years, that means 45 by 5 means 9 lakhs is going to be the depreciation that has to be provided. So normal entry, depreciation account at R2 fixed assets account 9 lakhs, P&L account at R2 depreciation account also 9 lakhs. But there is one more entry that has to be passed each year, recognizing a portion of deferred government grant as income. So how much percent to be recognized as income? Staking straight line. 5 years is there. So 10 lakhs government grant 5 years means each year you have to recognize 2 lakhs as income. So how to recognize income? Already deferred government grant was in credit. Now we have to debit it. So deferred government grants account debt are 2 lakhs to P&L account 2 lakhs. So P&L credited means what? We are taking it as it is income. So this is the treatment. If you observe the net effect, it is same. Net effect is 7 lakhs only is charged against the profits. But the way it is charged is different. You cannot say anyway net effect is same, so I will do anyway. No, not like that. Whatever the question asks, that we have to create and write the journal entries. So in this method, which is method 2, treating the deferred grant as treating the government grant as deferred revenue, in this case depreciation will be on normal basis because asset has no change in its book value. Here depreciation is calculated normally, but the government grant which was received in 1 year will be charged or will be credited to the P&L account, will be treated as income of various years throughout the life of that asset on some systematic and rational basis. Normally when nothing is mentioned, systematic rational basis means straight line basis only. Equally we recognize it over the period of life of the asset. In this case 2 lakhs will be treated as income over the period of life of the asset. Then what entries will repeat in the second year? Naturally the depreciation entry and recognition of deferred government grant as income entry. Same entries will repeat in the second year also. Depreciation account at R2, fixed assets account. Then P&L account at R2, depreciation account. Then deferred government grant account at R2, P&L account. That's all. So deferred government grant account at the beginning of the receipt of grant will be 10 lakhs. At the end of first year, it will be 8 lakhs. End of second year, it will be 6 lakhs. Like that, it will go on to reduce 4 to 4 lakhs, like that, then 2 lakhs. Then by end of fifth year, it will be 0, like that. Deferred government grant is a separate item which is shown on the liability side of the balance sheet. And that will be reduced over a period of time by crediting it to P&L account each year on a systematic and rational basis. That is method number 2. According to what is asked in the exam questions, you have to be able to write the journal entries for any of these methods. That's it. These are the two major things which are related to the treatment of government grants received towards acquisition of a specific fixed asset. Now let us look at another example or a situation or a case which can be asked as a question. Santosh Limited has received a grant of 8 crores rupees from the government for setting up a factory in the backward area. So it received a grant of 8 crores. Why is that? Why it has received? For setting up a factory in the backward area. Out of this grant, the company distributed 2 crores as dividend. Also, Santosh Limited received land free of cost from the state government, but it has not recorded it all in the books of accounts as no money has been spent. In the light of AS 12, examine whether the treatment of both the grants is correct. Both are wrong. Both are wrong. Both are inappropriate. You have to write very clearly, referring to the provisions of Accounting Standard 12. According to Accounting Standard 12, when a grant is received towards setting up of a factory in the backward area means it is a capital grant. It is not a revenue grant also. It is not a grant that is related to acquisition of any specific fixed assets also. But it can be treated as a capital grant, which means whatever the grant that it has received, 8 crores rupees, that has to be credited to capital reserve. When we say capital reserve, that is something which cannot be used for distribution of dividend. It is not possible to use that for the purpose of distribution of dividend. So the Santosh Limited, whatever the what they did, they distributed 2 crores among this 8 crores as dividend. So that is wrong. They should not have distributed it as dividend. Since it is a capital grant, dividend cannot be distributed out of that. That is the first point I have to write. Hence, distribution of dividend of 2 crores from this 8 crores of capital grant received from government is inappropriate. Same way, free land that it has received, whatever the area of land may be, Santosh Limited did not record it at all. That is also wrong. According to Accounting Standard 12, when non-monetary government grant, you have to use this word, just stories will not give you marks. Non-monetary government grant is received by an organization for free of cost, it shall be recorded at a nominal value. once again that word nominal value has to be there in the answer. So even in this case, Santosh Limited did not record this land at all in its books of accounts. That is also inappropriate. It should record the land in its books of accounts at some nominal value according to AS 12. So you need to write the provision, look at the situation correctly, then conclude by applying that provision to this situation, whatever the final answer may be. So that is how the presentation has to be. These type of questions can very well be expected from any standard. This standard is also not an exception. Certain questions will be journal entries based questions. Certain questions can be just application of standard from a conceptual point of view. Either way, questions can be asked. Now, let us continue with some more key points, very important points. Some of them we know already. There is nothing new in all cases. But just for remembering once again, reiterating certain aspects, because each of them can be called as a separate point. You know, 5 marks question, 5 different cases can be asked. How will you treat a free land given by government? How will you treat a capital grant given? How will you treat depreciable asset? Like that. Many, many things. How will you treat promoter's contribution? Like this, many types of questions can be asked. So each of them becomes an important separate item by itself. So first point here is to note, grants related to non-depreciable assets should be created to capital reserve. We already seen that. However, if a grant related to a non-depreciable asset requires the fulfillment of certain obligations, the grant should be created to income over the same period over which the cost of meeting such obligation is charged to income. Charged to income means charged against income, that is charged to P&L account, in other words. So that is also one thing that we already discussed. Government grants related to revenue, this is one thing new. After the capital grants, grants related to specific fixed assets, non-monetary grants, revenue grants also could be there. This is something new. This also is a very important point. If a grant is a revenue grant, then such a grant shall be recognized on a systematic basis in the P&L account over the periods necessary to match them with the related costs which they are intended to compensate. So, if at all that is related to 1 year, it will be recognized as income in that particular year, and that will be shown separately under other incomes, or they can be even deducted in reporting the related expenses. Either way, it can be done. So what is the treatment of revenue grant? Simply two possibilities. One, they are treated as other income by crediting to the P&L account, or they may be reduced from the related expenses also, which this government wants was intending to compensate. If it is related to 1 year, if it is not related to 1 year, if it is related to more than 1 year, then over the period of time when these revenue grants are received, to whatever extent the costs which are related to that revenue grant are incurred, they will be, in that period, the revenue grant should be recognized on a systematic basis in the P&L account. In general, revenue grant itself means it should be related to 1 year. So systematic basis, over a period of time, we don't need to really worry about them much when it comes to revenue grants. So what is the final treatment of revenue grants? Two possibilities: treating it as an income and showing under other incomes, or reducing it from related expenses. Simple. That is revenue grants. Then government grants of the nature of promoter's contribution should be created to capital reserve and treated as part of shareholders' funds but not distributable. This also we have seen. Anything like promoter's contribution, similar to this case where Santosh Limited has received a grant from the government for setting up a factory in backward area. It is as good as a setting up a factory means new factory, means promoters. Government is also acting as if it is also a promoter of this factory. It is giving a grant. It's in the nature of promoter's contribution, and that should be credited to the capital reserve. Of course, capital reserve will be under shareholders' funds, under reserves and surpluses, but it is not distributable. It cannot be distributed as dividend. Then, last point also we know already, government grants in the form of non-monetary assets given at a concessional rate should be accounted for on the basis of their acquisition cost if they are given at concessional rate. If the non-monetary asset is given at free of cost, then that should be recorded at nominal value. So these key points are covering everything that AS 12 is telling us, except specific fixed assets. Because specific fixed assets, we have anyway two treatments. One is reducing it from the cost of the asset. Second one is treating it as deferred income. Other than those two, everything that AS 12 covers are already mentioned in these key points. This is a very important slide and very important aspect of AS 12 that we should remember always and apply if any such situations arise. So we can classify this into two categories, this entire AS 12. One is related to specific fixed assets. Two is related to all other types of government grants. All other types of government grants are covered in this particular slide only. So in this slide and in these points, these points have to be carefully noted down and remembered also for application if required. These are the key points of AS 12 we can summarize. Then another issue comes, what should happen in case of refund of government grant? Actually speaking, we don't need to break our heads separately when there is a refund. What should happen? What are the entries you passed? You reverse them, that's all. Refund means, refund happens, okay, maybe whatever reasons because of which the refund has happened. But how to treat them in books of accounts? One answer for it, reverse. Whatever the entries are passed already, they have to be reversed. But reverse means not necessarily that all the things will have to be reversed exactly. Depends upon the amount of refund. So depending upon the amount of refund, the reversal entries have to be passed. Entry is reversal entry, no doubt. Amount could be different. That will depend upon facts of the case, which we have to calculate anyway in the questions that we will face. So simple logic for refund of government grant is nothing but reversal of the entry. Let us take one by one how this refund has to be treated. If the grant is related to revenue grant already received, that means already it was credited to the P&L account. Now refund is happening. So what should we do? Reverse it. Earlier it was credited to the P&L account. Now debited to the P&L account. That's it. However, even some revenue grants, because we have this revenue grants also should be recognized on a systematic basis in the P&L account. If at all, there is any unamortized deferred credit which is remaining in respect of the grant. If there is an unamortized deferred credit, then to the extent that the amount refundable exceeds any such deferred credit, or where there is no deferred credit exists, the amount is charged to the P&L account immediately. So if there is already some unamortized deferred credit, first that has to be debited. That has to be first debited. Then if that is also exhausted, P&L account has to be debited. Or when there is no unamortized deferred credit, directly P&L account has to be debited. So simply speaking, here when there is a refund of revenue grant, refund is happening means we are giving money back to the government. Credit is guaranteed. Credit is what? Cash or bank. Giving money back. Debit is the question. Debit depends upon if there is an unamortized deferred credit balance. If it is there, debit that first. If that is also exhausted, then debit P&L. If it is not there, debit P&L. So what will be the entry here? P&L account at R2, bank we can say, or refund of government grant. So you can just, if at all, passing an entry, P&L account at R, or you can say the entry can be passed in two levels. Refund of government grants account at R2, bank, then P&L account at R2, refund of government grants. Refund of government grants is only just a namesake item that will just come and go. What is the net effect of this? P&L account is debited with this refund. Bank account is credited because money is going out. That's it. That is related to revenue grants. Again, depends upon two cases. If there is no deferred credit unamortized, directly P&L account is debited. If there is any unamortized deferred credit, first that is debited. Over and above that, if there is any refund, excess refund, that will be debited to P&L. That is revenue grant. Coming to the grants refunded now, but when they were received, they were related to a specific fixed asset. And we know that there are two categories and two methods here, method 1 and method 2. So when we originally recorded using method 1, refund also has to be in such a case, which is matching to that method 1. What entry we passed then in method 1 when we received the grant? We said bank account at R2, fixed asset account. Now we have to reverse the entry. What will be the entry now? Fixed asset account at R2, bank. Simple. It is recorded by increasing the book value of the asset or by reducing the deferred income balance as appropriate by the amount refundable. So first point, first method is increasing the book value of the asset. In other words, entry will be what? Fixed assets account at R2, bank, with the amount of refund. Second method is also there. That is what? deferred income balance is already there. Normally deferred income means deferred government grant, which will be there on the credit side, already there. Now what we have to do? Debit it. So in that case, what entry will be there for refund? Deferred government grant account at R2 bank, as appropriate, as the method that is used. First method, increasing the value of the asset. Second method, reducing the value of deferred income or deferred government grant account balance. Any of them can be done, depending upon what method we used in the original instance. If we originally used the first method, now refund entry has to be fixed assets account at R2 bank. If we originally used the second method, now the refund entry has to be deferred government grant account at R2 bank. In the first alternative, of course, there is a change in the fixed asset, because of which the book value of the fixed asset is going to be increased now. What should happen to the depreciation on that? Of course, depreciation will have to be charged on the revised book value prospectively over the residual remaining useful life of the asset. Whatever the value of the asset has changed because of this refund, it will not have any impact on the past profits. It will have impact only on future profits. Why? By increasing the depreciation also. All these years we have provided a lesser depreciation. Now because of this refund, we increased the book value of the asset. Accordingly, the depreciation also will be increased. But whatever the useful life of the asset remaining is there, this amount, which is revalued amount or increased amount, revised book value we can call it, that will be spread over the remaining life of the asset prospectively. Very important word there is prospectively. Whenever there is any change in the book value of the asset or useful life of the asset, even if you remember accounting standard 10 also, the effective depreciation has to be given prospectively only. That will be there here also applicable, because there is a change in the book value of the asset because of refund of government grant in the first method. That is the entries that we should use in case of refund of a grant which was originally related to acquisition of a specific fixed asset. Now, originally grant was received in relation to promoter's contribution, which was in the nature of promoter's contribution. What entry we passed originally? Bank account at R2, capital reserve. Now we have to reverse it simply. So what entry we will pass now? Capital reserve account at R2, bank. That's all. So if it is refundable in part or in full to the government, or non-fulfillment of certain specified conditions, whatever it is, refundable. Why it is refundable? Naturally, it will be refundable because the organization did not satisfy some conditions. Then the amount which is refundable or refundable by the organization or recoverable by the government is reduced from capital reserve. Reduced means how? Entry is reversed. Simply, capital reserve account at R2 bank. That is entry. So simple logic when we talk about refund of government grants, what we have to remember is, whatever we did originally, that is why original treatment is important. If you remember original treatment correctly, refund is nothing but reversal of that original treatment. But refund entries and refund questions are more popular. Why? Because they will cover the original entries also, and they will cover the refund entries also. So they will be most probably asked in the exams, that is refund related questions. Logic, if you remember, it is simple. Reverse the original entries. That's all. While doing so, you have to always keep in mind what was the original treatment. Then automatically, when there is a refund, original entry has to be reversed. That is about refund of government grants. With that, we can conclude the theoretical conceptual discussion on AS12. Of course, disclosure requirements will be there in any standard. Not all standards will have really importance in exam purposes, disclosure requirements. If there are many disclosures, like 5 to 6 disclosures or more than that, then you remember disclosures also, because they can be asked as theoretical questions. These type of standards, only a couple of disclosures. What they will have to disclose? Whatever happened, that only they have to disclose. What accounting policy they have adopted for government grants? For example, did they use method 1 or method 2, if at all there was a grant related to fixed assets? What is the method of presentation in the financial statement? What presentation they are showing in the financial statements, they have to disclose that. And not only that, nature and extent of government grants recognized in the financial statements, including the grants of non-monetary assets also given at a concessional rate or free of cost. If there are anything such items received, they will not be much visible in the financial statements. That is why a separate note has to be written disclosure has to be made that so and so non-monetary asset has been received from government this year and it has been recorded like this. This item or this fact has to be disclosed in the financial statements, naturally in the notes to accounts. These are the basic disclosure requirements of government grants in the financial statements, we can say. Now moving on to some of the questions, problems related to accounting standard 12. Let us go through them one by one. Question number one. Tip Top Limited has set up its business in a designated backward area which entitles the company to receive from the government of India a subsidy of 20% of the cost of investment. So it is going to set up a business in a designated backward area which entitles the company to receive from the government a subsidy of 20% of the cost of investment. Having fulfilled all the conditions under the scheme, the company on its investment of 50 crores in capital assets received 10 crores from the government in January 2017. Accounting period viewing 2016-17. That means 31st March 2017 is going to be the date of balance sheet. The company wants to treat this receipt as an item of revenue and thereby reduce the losses on profit and loss account for the year ended 31st March 2017. Oh, it has happily received 10 crores rupees. It wanted to credit the P&L account. It wants to treat it as revenue means what? It wanted to credit to P&L account by which they want to show lesser losses for that year ended 31st March 2017. Keeping in view the relevant accounting standard, discuss whether this action is justified or not. Is it justified? Absolutely not. Again, you have to refer to accounting standard 12. This is not a revenue grant. This is not a revenue grant. This is a grant that is given by the government while Tip and Top Limited was setting up a new business in a designated backward area, which means it is in the nature of a promoter's contribution. Neither it is a revenue grant, nor it is a grant related to any specific asset. So, definitely, the only treatment that Tip and Top Limited is supposed to do according to accounting standard 12 is bank account at R2, capital reserve. The grant that is received from government for this purpose, which is of capital nature, shall be credited to the capital reserve. It cannot be credited to the P&L account. This cannot be treated as income. It cannot be treated as revenue. It cannot be credited to the P&L account as was planned by Tip and Top Limited. So whatever the treatment of Tip and Top Limited is, that is inappropriate. It is not justified according to AS12. That's it. It has to be finally what? Conclusion what? It has to be credited to capital reserve, not to P&L account at all. That's it. And that capital reserve also you can even mention is a capital nature. It is of capital nature, which means it is non-distributable. It cannot be distributed as dividend also. That is the conclusion that you have to write for this question. Second question. Z Limited purchased a fixed asset for 50 lakhs, which has an estimated useful life of... Okay, I think the same question, but refund is there, yeah. So Z Limited purchased a fixed asset of 50 lakhs, estimated useful life of 5 years, salvage value 5 lakhs. Same story, what we have already seen earlier. On purchase of these assets, government granted it a grant for 10 lakhs. This amount was earlier reduced from the cost of asset. Grant was considered as refundable in the end of second year to the extent of 7 lakhs. Pass the journal entry for refund of the grant as per the first method. First method means here, already it was given. Amount of grant was reduced from the cost of fixed asset means that is first method. Now the entry is not for that. Entry is for refund of the grant. So if you consider both these problems together, that becomes exam question. What entry you would have passed originally when the grant is received and when originally fixed asset is purchased? Fixed asset account at R2, bank account 50 lakhs, first year entry. Then bank account at R2, fixed asset account 10 lakhs. Then depreciation account at R2, fixed asset account 7 lakhs. P&L account at R2, depreciation account 7 lakhs, first year entry is done. Second year also the same entry would have been passed. But before that happened, the grant became refundable at the end of second year itself. that is to the extent of 7 lakhs. Now what entry should be passed? Whatever the original entry related to receipt of grant was passed, it has to be reversed. So now what entry should be passed? Fixed asset account at R2 bank. Originally we passed an entry bank account at R2 fixed asset for receipt of government grant. Now what entry will be passed for refund? Reversal of that. Reverse entry is fixed assets account at R2 bank account. That is 7 lakhs rupees. That is a journal entry for refund. Now the point to be noted is, next year onwards, what will be the depreciation? Okay, let us consider this as if the depreciation for this year also is already provided, because this refund happened at the end of second year. End of second year is as good as beginning of third year. So this year's depreciation was also, let us say, 7 lakhs only. Original asset purchased was 50 lakhs and grant received was then 10 lakhs. Originally the book value was 40 lakhs. Then first year depreciation was 7 lakhs. Let us consider second year depreciation also has been provided as 7 lakhs. End of second year this refund and all happened. So what is the book value by the end of second year for this asset? 40 minus 14. That will be 26, right? Now what happens? Now what happens? Now this will be increased with this 7 lakhs, which means that becomes 33. And how many years is remaining? 3 years is remaining. So what will be the depreciation for the future 3 years? That will be 11 lakhs. That is also possible to be asked as a question. We need to understand the impact of this. Originally, full story we need to understand. 50 lakhs original purchase price, 10 lakhs received as government grant, and according to their treatment, we reduced it from cost of asset. 40 became the net actual cost of asset. First year depreciation 7 lakhs, second year depreciation 7 lakhs. So the asset value in the books of accounts at the end of second year is 26 lakhs. Now because of this refund entry, fixed asset value is increased by 7 lakhs. So it became 33 lakhs. How many more years is their life? That is 3 years. Or actually, we have to consider the scrap value also, no? So we cannot take 11 lakhs. So 33 is there, okay, fine. 33 minus 5. That divided by 3. How much ever that may be. That will be the depreciation. 9.33 lakhs will be the depreciation for 3 years. 9,33,333 will be the depreciation for the coming 3 years for future period. This is how refund of government grant is treated. And the main point to note here is also, though it is not asked in the question, question answer is only one entry. It is not an exam question, it is only a practice question. This question will be coupled with original treatment also. Then only it becomes exam question. So original treatment plus refund entry, both of them we should be able to pass. But main point also to be noted here is, what is the impact of that on the depreciation of the asset prospectively? This is the impact. Earlier you were providing 7 lakhs depreciation annually for 2 years. Now for the remaining 3 years you have to provide 9.33 lakhs depreciation prospectively from now onwards, means third year onwards depreciation has to be provided at the rate of 9.33 lakhs each year. That is the impact of the government grant which has been refunded. Now look at another question, question number 3. On 1/4/2014, ABC Limited received a government grant of 300 lakhs rupees for acquisition of machinery costing 1500 lakhs. So it is definitely a grant related to a specific fixed asset. Grant was credited to the cost of the asset. It was credited to the cost of the asset. That means method 1. The life of the machinery is 5 years. The machinery is depreciated at 20% on WDV basis. Look at this. Different situation. The company had to refund the grant in May 2017 due to non-fulfillment of certain conditions. How would you deal with the refund of the grant in the books of ABC Limited? Assuming that the company did not charge any depreciation for the year 2017. So, for the year 2017 he is saying, okay, there is no depreciation charged for that year. In other words, up to 16 only the depreciation is charged. So how many years depreciation has been charged, that we have to look at. But again, whether the year here means a calendar year or a financial year, that is something which has to be noted. we have to consider it as calendar year, because when it is said that depreciation is not charged for the year 2017, if it is mentioned instead of 16-17, that means we are talking about a calendar year, right? So 2017 is a calendar year, so the company follows calendar year as its financial year. That we have to first identify from the question itself. Now, what is the impact of that? How will you deal with the refund of the grant? Is telling refund of the grant is simple. Refund of the grant is what? Whatever the grant is received, it will be added back to the cost of the asset. So original entry would be what? Bank account at R2, fixed asset account, that was 300 lakhs. Now it will be fixed assets account at R2, bank account 300 lakhs. That is treatment. But the point is not just about refund. We have to also understand what is the impact of this. So what was the story originally? Let us say original cost of the asset was 1500 lakhs, right? Government grant 300 lakhs was received on that, right? And 1200 lakhs is going to be the net purchase price of the asset, we can say, after reducing the government grant from the cost of the asset. That was given very clearly. The grant was credited to the cost of the asset. It was given already. Life of the machinery is 5 years. We don't care, because the machinery here is depreciated at the rate of 20% on written down value basis. So when it is depreciated at the rate of 20% on written down value basis, so you need to calculate for various years, 2014, right, and 2015 and 2016 also. Depreciation has to be calculated on written down value basis. 2014, if you observe, it will not be for the full year. It will be only for 9 months, because the asset was purchased on 1/4/2014. So 1200 lakhs, 20% into 9/12. So what is the depreciation in that year? It will be 180. Remaining is how much? 1020. Once again, written down value method. On 1020, 20%. That will be 20%, right? Yeah. 20%, 204. First year depreciation was only for 9 months. Second year depreciation will be full year. Naturally, it will be higher because of that. So 204. The remaining is how much? 816. Then reduce on that 20% also, that will be 163.2. Reduce. Remaining will be how much? 652.8. Now what? This is the book value at the beginning of 2017, and the government company had to refund the entire grant. Entire grant. Nothing is mentioned means entire grant has to be refunded due to fulfillment of certain conditions. Whatever they are, we don't care. So what is the treatment now? Now it will be added to the cost of the asset. So what will be the entry here? Simply, entry is simple. Entry is nothing but fixed asset account at R2. Bank account. Amount is 300 lakhs. That's it. Now what happens to the fixed asset? That will be increased by 300. So now it will be how much? 952.8. So 952.8 will be the book value of the asset after adding this 300 to the original book value of that asset. And 952.8 has to be depreciated. It has to be depreciated for the remaining 2 years on a systematic basis. But they are depreciating on 20% WDV basis. That is not going to be enough now onwards. They have to change the depreciation. We are not asked about what is the solution for it, or what is the way that they have to choose. But definitely one thing for sure, they have to depreciate this 952.8 lakhs over the period of 2 years, that is 2017 and 2018. Ideally, that is what depreciation is supposed to be. How much is that? They may have to change the method, they may have to change the amount of depreciation. That depends upon what their accounting policy related to depreciation is according to S10. But what is the refund of government grant simply fixed asset account at R2? Bank account 300 lakhs, which is originally received earlier, now being refunded. That's all. That is question number 3. Then question number 4. A Limited purchased a machinery for 40 lakhs rupees. Useful life of 4 years and residual value of 8 lakhs. Government grant received is 16 lakhs. Show the journal entry to be passed at the time of refund of the grant in the third year and the value of the fixed assets. This is important. Value of the fixed assets. If the grant is credited to fixed assets account, that is method 1. Second is if the grant is credited to deferred grant account, method 2. So in both cases, what will be the entry to be passed at the time of refund is asking. That cannot be directly just done. Of course, entry wise it is okay, easily we can pass that entry. What will be the entry? Whatever the original entry, that should be reversed. So in the first method, what will be the entry? That will be now fixed assets account at R2 bank account, 16 lakhs, done. Then what about second method? There is the problem, because how much deferred grant account can be debited now? Whatever is there in the credit, that only can be debited. When you are refunding the entire grant, then deferred grant account will not be full amount available. So naturally the remaining amount has to be debited to P&L account. That is why we have to be careful with entry at the time of refund also. So what is the original case? Just for let us understand the story in sequence, that will be easier. See, what is the original situation? See, original cost of asset is 40 lakhs, okay? And government grant received was 16 lakhs, okay? First method we are talking. First method, 16 lakhs means it is reduced from the cost of the asset. So naturally the remaining will be 24 lakhs, fine. That looks like okay. That is the cost of the asset, right? Then useful life is 4 years, residual value is 8 lakhs, right? So 24 minus 8 lakhs divided by 4 years. So 24 minus 8, that is 16, divided by 4 is 4. So depreciation is 4 lakhs. So 4 lakhs, 4 lakhs, again. Third year, in the third year it was mentioned. So let us assume that depreciation is not passed in this third year yet. In the third year it was mentioned, not at the end of third year. So second year depreciation is already done. Third year itself grant was supposed to be refunded. So at the beginning of third year, what will be the book value of this asset after deducting depreciation for 2 years under straight-line method? Naturally it will be 16 lakhs. Now what is happening? Now government grant which was received earlier has to be refunded. That means entry has to be passed to fixed asset account at R2 bank account. Now what is the fixed asset value in the books of accounts? That's what he's asking. Value of fixed assets also is asking. So the answer is there, 32 lakhs. At the time of after refund of the grant, 32 lakhs is the value of fixed assets. But again, the story, full story, if you want to understand how this 32 lakhs will be depreciated. 32 lakhs minus original residual value 8 lakhs, which will be there. But how many more years is left? Out of 4 years, 2 years is gone. Remaining 2 years means 12 lakhs depreciation has to be provided for other two more years. This is only for understanding, you don't need to write this. So after this, residual value naturally will be remaining, that is 8 lakhs. This is the full story of the asset with the government grant when the grant is credited to fixed assets account. What is that we have to write there? Entry. Entry is simple. Fixed assets account at R2, bank account 16 lakhs. What is the value of fixed assets? 32 lakhs. That is the answer. For showing 32 lakhs, you have to show this calculation. 32 lakhs has to be shown as a calculation clearly. That will give the answer for first question. Second case, if the grant is credited to deferred grant account, then the situation is different. So then original fixed asset remains 40 lakhs only. There is a deferred government grant account separately. That is 16 lakhs. Okay. Now, in the first year, depreciation has to be provided. 40 lakhs minus 8 lakhs divided by 4. That means 8 lakhs depreciation has to be provided here in the first year. So asset becomes 32 lakhs. And in this, 16 lakhs has to be recognized over 4 years. That means 4 lakhs would have been already credited to P&L account in the first year. So how much will be deferred government grant account, which is a liability account, on the credit side is 12 lakhs. So this deferred government grant account is also there, 12 lakhs balance at the end of first year. Same thing happens at second year also, because second year is also finished. So value of the fixed asset according to this method will be how much? 24 lakhs. And a deferred government grant remaining in the credit side of the books of accounts is 8 lakhs. Now the time has come to refund this grant. Now the entry is very important. Refund amount is 16 lakhs. But amount remaining in the deferred government grant account is only 8 lakhs. So what entry we should pass? Simply, deferred government grant account at R, 8 lakhs. P&L account at R, 8 lakhs. To bank, 16 lakhs. That is the entry under second method. That's what is asked. So we need to know exactly how much is the balance in deferred government grant account. We need to know the story for because of that. And according to this method, fixed asset is not at all touched. So its original depreciation of 8 lakhs was there already, whatever it is there. Now what happens to fixed assets going forward? Nothing happens. Its story will be same. Third year also it will have 8 lakhs. Then it becomes 16. Then also a fourth year also it will have 8 lakhs depreciation. Then finally the residual value 8 lakhs will remain. So there is no change in the depreciation at all in the second method. In the first method, there is going to be a depreciation change after the refund is added back to the fixed asset value, and depreciation earlier was only 4 lakhs per year. Now it has become 12 lakhs per year for the remaining 2 years. Whereas in the second method, if you observe, depreciation has not changed even after the refund of the grant, because the grant itself originally was not touching the fixed asset value at all. It is dealt separately through an account called deferred government grant account. Now that account is nullified. It had a balance of 8 lakhs. So that is debited now. Remaining balance of 8 lakhs, which is a loss now, has to be recognized through P&L account. So the entry in that case will be deferred government grant account at R, P&L account at R, to bank account. And amount of value in the fixed asset, final answer here will be 24 lakhs in the second method. This is an exam question, quite possible to be asked in the exams, because it covers the original treatment also. Though you don't have to pass journal entries, you should know the original treatment. And it covers the accounting treatment or journal entry for refund also. That's it. Now, similar questions are there. A fixed asset is purchased for 20 lakhs. Government grant received towards it is 8 lakhs. Residual value is 4 lakhs. Useful life is 4 hours. Assume depreciation on the basis of straight line method. Asset is shown in the balance sheet net of grant, which means net of grant means it is first method. After 1 year, grant becomes refundable to the extent of 5 lakhs due to non-compliance with certain conditions. Pass journal entries for the first 2 years. First 2 years he is asking. So this is a plausible question very much. So what is the first year entry? Naturally, when the asset is purchased, fixed asset account at R, to bank, what are the amount of purchase it is? How much was that? 20 lakhs. Then grant is received how much? 8 lakhs, right? So when grant is received originally, this is first year. Grant is received, bank account at R2, fixed asset account. How much is the amount? 8 lakhs. That is the entry when grant is received from the government, 8 lakhs rupees. Now depreciation. For first year, we have to provide on the basis of the information that is given. So 20 lakhs originally fixed asset, in that grant is 8 lakhs. So once you reduced it, 12 lakhs only it became. Residual value is 4 lakhs minus divided by useful life is 4 years, means each year depreciation is supposed to be 2 lakhs. In the first year, we don't know. We cannot dream that we are going to refund the grant in second year. We'll provide as if it is normal things. So first year depreciation will be 2 lakhs. So naturally the entry will be depreciation account at R2, fixed asset account, 2 lakhs. That is the entry for depreciation. Of course, it will not be enough. Then P&L account at R2, depreciation. We have to charge the depreciation to the P&L account. That will be 2 lakhs. That is the entries. These are the series of entries for the first year. done. Then what happened? After first year, he said, after first year is over, must be in the second year, grant became refundable. Whenever it is, we don't mind. That is, let us not get into the dates and all, not required. Depreciation will be different now. We don't need to worry about it. Let us say, sometime at the beginning of second year itself, let us say, grant becomes refundable to the extent of 5 lakhs due to non-compliance with certain conditions. So when the grant becomes refundable, naturally, the entry here will be reverse entry. Fixed asset account debtor to bank. Whatever the original grant received amount was 8 lakhs. That has to be reversed. Fixed assets account debtor to bank account 8 lakhs rupees. Reversal entry for refund. But main point here is in the second year, depreciation, how it has to be calculated. That is the main point. So for that purpose, you need to know what is the story of the fixed assets fully. You can do this a separate working note. Originally, fixed asset purchase is 20 lakhs. Grant received 8 lakhs. So it became 12. Then first year depreciation was 2 lakhs. So it became 10. Right? In the books of accounts. Now, again it increased by 8. Which means, now book value is 18. How much would be the depreciation that is provided? With the book value of 18 lakhs, and how many more years remaining? 3 more years remaining. Useful life is 4 years. Only 1 year depreciation was already provided. So calculate carefully. 18 lakhs minus salvage value 4 lakhs, that is 14 lakhs, divided by 3. So the depreciation that should be provided account debtor to fixed asset account will be how much? 4,66,667. 466,667 is the depreciation for the second year also, third year also, fourth year also, naturally. Once 3 years is over, that will be remaining residual value of 8 lakhs. That will be remaining in the 4 lakhs. Residual value of 4 lakhs will remain in the final books of accounts, because currently the book value of the asset is 18 lakhs. So 18 minus 4 divided by 3, simple. That is the amount, 4.667 lakhs or 4,66,667. Then naturally depreciation has to be charged to P&L account. So once again, same P&L account debtor to depreciation account, same 466,667. That's all. And this 460, these two entries will repeat for the next 2 years also. That is about accounting treatment for government grants and refund of government grants also. Very much possible to be asked as a question. Journal entries have to be clearly written. Calculations have to be shown in the working note. And you have to write some text also referring to accounting standard 12. And narrations are must. Keep those things in mind while answering those questions in the examination. Now let us move on to another question. Question number 6. Viva Limited received a specific grant of 30 lakhs rupees for acquiring the plant of 150 lakhs during the 16-17 year, having a useful life of 10 years. Grant received was credited to deferred income in the balance sheet and was not deducted from the cost of the plant. That means second method has been followed. It was credited to deferred income in the balance sheet. During 1920, due to non-compliance of conditions laid down in the grant, the company had to refund the whole grant, entire grant, to the government. Balance in the deferred income on that date was 21 lakhs. Written down value of the plant was 105 lakhs. What should be the treatment of the refund of the grant and the effect on the cost of the fixed asset and the amount of depreciation to be charged during the year 2019-20 in the profit and loss account? This can be a perfect question. First of all, we have to keep in mind we are following a second method here, not first method. That means cost of fixed asset is first of all unaffected. It is not going to be affected at all. It will remain the same. So whatever the cost of the fixed asset originally is, that will be just continued. Just for understanding purposes, let us check what they have done. 150 lakhs was the original acquisition cost of the plant. 30 lakhs was the government grant, but it is not credited to the cost of the asset. So 150 is remaining like that only. 30 will be where? In the deferred government grant account separately. So this 150 minus, is there any residual value that is given? Not given. So each year 15 lakhs is going to be the depreciation. So 2016-17, you don't need to check that, just for identifying what they have done. 17-18 and 18-19, 3 years depreciation has been provided. 16-17 in the year in which the asset is purchased, 17-18 and 18-19. How much is depreciation? 15 lakhs, 15 lakhs, 15 lakhs, if at all they provided straight line method. That means now the value of the asset that is given in the question also, the written down value of the plant is 105 lakhs. That's how it has been already there. Same way, if you just observe this 30 lakhs deferred government grant, which has to be spread over a period of 10 years, means each year how much has to be credited to P&L? 3 lakhs has to be credited. Like that, 3 lakhs, 3 lakhs, 3 lakhs, 3 years. That means 21 lakhs is the amount of balance in the deferred government grant account. That is 21 lakhs. Now, the point is, this is already what is there, existing scenario. We just are identifying how these amounts are coming. Now what happened? The company Viva Limited had to refund the entire government grant, whatever it has received. How much it received? 30 lakhs. But how much is there in the deferred government grant account? Only 21 lakhs. So what should we do? Deferred government grant account at R? 21 lakhs. Remaining amount, there is no option. What has to be debited? P&L account has to be debited with 9 lakhs. To bank, that is 30 lakhs. This is the entry that Viva Limited has to pass on the refund of this government grant. That is the first question answer. What should be the effect on the cost of the fixed asset? Answer is no effect. Because it is the second method that we are following. Don't write first method, second method in exam. First, second method, first method, for our reference we are looking at. Second method means fixed asset value is unaffected when the government grant is separately treated through a deferred government grant account. That's what I should write. Hence, cost of fixed asset will not be affected. Depreciation will not be affected also. When cost of fixed asset is not affected, how will depreciation be affected? It will not be affected also. These 2 points separately have to write, that those 2 points are theory things. For that, you will get 2 marks. And for calculations and showing this journal entry, you will get the remaining marks. So this is possible examination question. Once again, you have to refer to the provisions very carefully. One, at least 3-4, 2-3 sentences you have to write about what is the accounting standard talking about this. So you have to write like accounting standard 12, according to accounting standard 12, when there is a refund of the government grant which was originally credited to the originally treated as deferred income, then the refund amount initially has to be debited to the deferred income account to the extent of the credit balance that is already available, and if any excess amount is supposed to be refunded, that has to be charged to the P&L account. What have we done? All that story is shown in the journal entry only, but that also has to be written. Why you have treated like this? Not just because we wanted to treat like this, because AS 12 told us. So that has to be written in the exam questions. According to AS 12, so and so treatment is supposed to be done, so I am treating like this. Then you will get marks. Of course, the final two things, what will be the cost of fixed asset? No effect on the cost of fixed asset, no effect on the amount of depreciation also. That can be written as conclusion for other questions. Clear? Next, one more question. This is also past examination question. D Limited acquired a machine on 1-4-2012 for 20 lakhs rupees. Useful life is 5 years. The company had applied on 1-4-2012 only for a subsidy to the tune of 80% of the cost of the asset. Sanction letter for subsidy was received in November 2015. They have purchased the asset on 1-4-2012. Sanction letter came in November 2015. Government, kada? So it will take some time sometimes. In fact, most of the times. The company's fixed assets account for the financial year 15-16 shows a credit balance as under. So that's what it is showing. Look at that. Machine original cost 20 lakhs and accumulated depreciation because 12-13, 13-14. And 14-15, 3 years depreciation was already provided, right? So 20 lakhs 5 years means 4 lakhs each year, 4 lakhs into 3 means 12 lakhs. So they provided already depreciation of 12 lakhs on these 20 lakhs, which means book value of the asset now is 8 lakhs. Now the grant is received 16 lakhs. They are showing balance of the asset negative 8 lakhs. Is it possible? How can the asset value be negative? Does it make sense? No, it does not make sense. Okay, asset value cannot be negative. That doesn't make sense. Property, plant and equipment has to be positive value. So what they have done here is they have reduced 16 lakhs from the book value of 8 lakhs and shown 8 lakhs as negative balance. Question is, you are required to explain how should the company deal with this asset in the accounts for 15-16. So how should they deal with it? Ideally, they have to deal like this. This is a simple theory question once again. Asset value cannot go negative. Since the amount of grant received is more than the book value of the asset, depreciation already happened. This we cannot reverse directly. But indirectly we can reverse that. How? By crediting this 8 lakhs to the P&L account. So what can be the entry now here? Bank account at R, 16 lakhs. You cannot credit fixed asset account 16 lakhs because debit itself is 8 lakhs. So two fixed asset, whatever it is, 8 lakhs. So what is the remaining 8 lakhs to be treated as? That is to be credited to P&L account. There is no option. So this can be treated as one way, reversal of the depreciation excessively provided in the earlier years. Earlier years, excessively depreciation was provided and debited to P&L account. Now that reversal of that happening to the extent of 8 lakhs by crediting it to the P&L account in this year when the grant is actually received. Okay, but one more point. We have to also write here the sanction letter for the subsidy was received, not that money is already received. So that is another point you have to write. Recognition of government grant in accordance with accounting standard 12 has to be done only when there is a reasonable assurance that the grant will be received. Of course, sanction letter received means that is a definite reasonable assurance, we can say. After giving the sanction letter also on official letterhead, we cannot expect that government will not grant that. That is not a valid assumption. So definitely grant would be received, there is a reasonable assurance. So what they have to do is, instead of crediting the fixed asset with 16 lakhs, they have to credit the fixed asset with only 8 lakhs and credit the remaining 8 lakhs to P&L account. That can be the treatment there in that particular situation. Then question number 8, a specific government grant of 15 lakhs was received by USB Limited. This is a specific grant for acquiring a high-tech dairy plant of 95 lakhs during the year 14-15. Plant has a useful life of 10 years. Grant received was created to deferred income in the balance sheet. So that means once again second method. Should always keep in mind which method is followed by any organization as per the question. During 17-18, due to non-compliance of conditions laid down in the grant, company had to refund the whole of the grant to the government. Balance in the deferred income on that date was 10.5 lakhs. Written down value of the plant was 66.5 lakhs. We don't need to check that. Not necessarily also. Because we don't know what method they are following and all that. Just for understanding purposes, earlier in one of the questions, we have checked it. Not that we have to show it in the exams. Already it is given. The credit balance in the deferred grant account is 10.5 lakhs. Written down value of the plant on the asset side is 66.5 lakhs. That is the reality now. Now the question is, what should be the treatment of the refund of the grant and effect on the cost of plant and amount of depreciation to be charged in 17-18 in P&L account? Same question like earlier. What should be the treatment of refund of the grant? Original grant was how much? 15 lakhs. And balance in deferred government grant account is only 10.5 lakhs, where the remaining 4.5 lakhs has to be debited. Naturally, P&L account. So, deferred government grant account at R, 10.5 lakhs. P&L account at R, 4.5 lakhs. To bank, 15 lakhs. That will be the treatment of refund of government grant in this case. That's it. Because they have refunded, always you have to read this also. Not necessarily every time the entire grant has to be refunded. Here it is whole grant had to be refunded. When it is whole grant had to be refunded, you have to give back entire 15 lakhs to government. Then, what will be the impact on the cost of the plant? No impact. Same way, what will be the impact on depreciation? No impact. Because originally, when grant was received, that was not reduced from the cost of the asset. So, cost of the asset was depreciated over the period of time without getting impacted by the government grant. Now with the refund also there will be not any impact on the cost of the asset. That's it. But now, second question is important, and this type of question, two questions will make it a 5 marks perfect question. What should be the treatment of the refund if grant was deducted from the cost of the plant during 14-15? Assuming that the plant showed a balance of 56 lakhs as on 1-4-2017. Okay, we don't need to once again go back to stories and all. Already when it is given, at the beginning of our year 2017-18, plant showed a balance of 56 lakhs. Then what will be the treatment of the refund? Simply, fixed asset account has to be increased by that amount. So fixed asset account at our two bank, how much is that? 15 lakhs. That's it. Now how much will be the fixed asset value in the books of accounts? 56 lakhs is already there, plus 15 lakhs. Means how much? 71 lakhs will be the book value of the asset now. Okay? That is the situation. And what is the method of depreciation and all? We don't know. But particularly, since it is asked about amount of depreciation, what should be the treatment of the refund, he said. That is clear. Treatment of refund is fixed assets account at R2 bank. But just for understanding, if this 56 lakhs is showing any clear indication of a straight line method, we can check that. If not, we just ignore that. We don't need to find out WDV rate and all if it is not there. So originally, let us just check that. In general, it will be straight line only. Original cost of the plant was 95. It would have been reduced from that, the government grant. So remaining would have been 80. And is there any residual value? Nothing is mentioned. But it has a useful life of 10 years. So 8 lakhs is going to be the depreciation for each year. Straight line method. So which years are there? 2014-15. 2014-15, 15-16, and 16-17, I think. Yeah, we are talking about now 17-18, during the which the refund happened. So 16-17 also depreciation provided. So how many years depreciation provided? 8, 8, 8, which means how much is going to be the book value of the plant after providing depreciation? 56 lakhs. It is matching. So definitely they are providing straight line method. Now we can understand. Now 71 lakhs is the new book value of the plant after the first 3 years. And since there is no other residual value and all mentioned, it should be depreciated over a period of 7 years. So how much will be the depreciation for the remaining 7 years? 71 by 7, it will be approximately 10.143 lakhs will be the depreciation that should be provided over a period of 7 years. That's what you can write also. When the grant is refunded, it will have a change of depreciation prospectively. All these things can be written as provisions of Accounting Standard 12 and explained and concluded with the numbers. That will give full marks for such type of questions. Now, question number 9. How would you treat the following in the accounts in accordance with AS-12 government grants? Like this, 5 points given, 5 marks is a fantastic question. But here only 3 given, no problem. 35 lakhs received from local authority for providing medical facilities to the employees. So it is a revenue grant. Two ways it can be done. Either it can be treated as other income, 35 lakhs, or it can be reduced from the relative expenditure, that is employee benefit expenditure. So both the possibilities are there. So that you have to write. Since it is a revenue grant, it is possible to be treated as either other incomes, or it can be reduced from the expenses related to that grant, which is employee benefit expenses, according to AS-12. Second, 100 lakhs received as subsidy from central government for setting up a unit in a notified backward area. It should be credited to capital reserve. Simple. It is a kind of promoter's contribution. So, amount of grant 100 lakhs has to be credited to capital reserve. Third, 10 lakhs grant received from central government on installation of anti-pollution equipment. Okay, that is why 3 points are given. Each of them will have two options. So here there are two options. One is to treat it as other income. Other one is to treat it as deduction from expenses, reduction of expenses. So each of them one mark. This is 1 mark. Here also two possibilities are there. One is it can be reduced from the cost of the asset, or it can be treated as deferred income. Both you have to write. So method one, method two, both you have to write. It's a theory question actually. How could you treat means you have to write about theoretically what are the provisions of accounting standard 12 in those specific circumstances. Very perfect theoretical question only. Those amounts have nothing to be calculated, but you have to write exactly what AS12 has told about them. Ultimately, these are the only things majorly are there. Some are revenue grants, some are capital grants, some are grants related to specific fixed assets. One more point can be added, which is like a non-monetary grant, which will be recorded at actual cost if it is received at concessional rate, or some nominal value if it is received free of cost. Other than that, nothing else is there in AS12. That is the essence of AS12. Next, look at another question, that is question number 10, the last one. On 1/4/2014, XYZ Limited received a government grant of 100 lakhs for acquisition of new machinery costing 500 lakhs. The grant was received and credited to the cost of the asset. So credited to the cost of the asset means what? That is reduced from the cost of the asset. In other words, method 1. Lifespan of the machinery was 5 years. Machinery is depreciated at 20% on WDV method. And the company had to refund the entire grant on 2nd April 2017. So when they have purchased this asset, 1/4/2014. So 14, 15, 15, 16, and even 16, 17 also depreciation would have been provided. So only just one day after 16, 17 finished, they had to refund the grant due to non-fulfillment of certain conditions which was imposed by government at the time of approval of the grant. How do you deal with the refund of the grant to the government in the books of XYZ Limited as per AS12? How do you treat means you cannot just write one entry and be silent. You have to talk about depreciation and other things. So what is the situation here? WDV method depreciation is there, but whatever the method it is, we have to first find out what is the existing book value of the asset. So originally what was the government grant that was received? 100 lakhs government grant, correct. From the cost of the asset was 500 lakhs. Right, and it was credited to the cost of the asset, means it is reduced from the cost of the asset, the government grant. And what is the remaining amount is 400 lakhs. 20% is the WDV that they are following, 3 years you can say. So you have to just calculate. So 400 into 20%, 1 year 80 lakhs, remaining will be 320, again 20%. 64 lakhs, remaining will be 256. Third year also depreciation will be provided, again 20%, 51.2 lakhs all of them, remaining is 204.8. Now this has to be increased by the grant that was refunded. How much will be refunded? Same 100 lakhs will be refunded. What entry will pass when grant is refunded? In case of first method, same entry, fixed assets account at R2, bank account, that is 100 lakhs. That entry you have to write and show. And how much is the book value of the asset now? That will be 304.8 lakhs. And this will be depreciated over the remaining life of the asset prospectively. That's it. You don't need to write about how much will be and all that. If it is straight line method, you can calculate. It makes sense. If it is WDV, 20% is definitely not going to be enough now onwards. It has to be definitely revised because original cost of the asset has changed. And now, if you continue to provide depreciation at 20% on WDV method, that will not be sufficing. We don't need to worry about all that. That is their policy. Our job is to treat the government grant. How it will be treated? It will be added to the cost of the asset. It will be added to the value of the asset, book value of the asset. And now 304.8 lakhs will have to be depreciated prospectively over the remaining life of the asset. That's what you should write. How and all, it is none of our business. That's it. These are the various aspects related to the government grants. With that, we can conclude this accounting standard 12. As usual, core provisions have to be remembered and core terminology has to be remembered. Practice of questions is very important. Similar questions can be very well asked in the examinations. More and more you understand each of the concepts of the questions, that will be easier to answer such questions in the main exam and score very good marks in this accounting standards segment of the accounts paper. With that, we'll conclude accounting standard 12, and in the next session we'll discuss about some other accounting standard. Till then, take care. Bye bye. Thank you very much.